Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get 3 free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.
Welcome. You're listening to the Financial Survival Network. I'm Kerry Lutz, and we've got Mark Skousen with us now from Freedom Fest, and just wanted to touch base with him because he's got some exciting news. Mark, how are you?
Hey, I'm doing well, and I hope you're doing well also.
Yes.
During the holiday season.
Yeah. I can't believe the holidays are upon us already, but hey, the good thing is that Freedom Fest is that much closer, and hey, holidays, family that you like, the family that you don't like that much, but at least you get to see them. And hey, so you got major plans going on besides the thing that I'm really looking forward to, which is Steve Moore debating the Nobel laureate economist Paul Krugman, who's done such a fine job helping our economy get back on track, right? But besides that, we got this, what I'm really into, because kind of become a de facto entrepreneur week on the Financial Survival Network. You got the what you're calling the American Dream Award coming up, which I think is really cool. Why don't you tell us about that?
Yeah, the American Dream Award was actually the title of that was actually selected by Barbara Cochran, who's a member of the program Shark Tank on TV. We actually met her in Salt Lake City, and I showed her my business card, and I was telling her about our idea of giving a $50,000 award. Her eyes lit up. She said, "Wow, that's a great amount, and I love what you're doing, and why don't you call it, since your theme is Can We Restore the American Dream for Freedom Fest, why don't you call it the American Dream Award?" So we're giving $50,000 winner take all in a contest that anybody can apply for. Basically, if you have an idea or if you have a business that you've just started, a startup, and you need $50,000 to jumpstart your business, make an application. If you just go to freedomfest.com, we're putting up all the details that's going to be coming out shortly on how you apply. And what's going to happen, we're going to have some experts who are serial entrepreneurs who are going to be our initial judges who are putting this thing together. Brian June is leading this. He's an entrepreneur, a multimillionaire himself, and he's going to vet all of them and reduce it down to 100 candidates who then will be invited to come to Freedom Fest, have a little table in one of our rooms, and so people can look at what they're doing, maybe invest if they want to. And then out of those 100, 4 will be selected to come in the celebrity ballroom at Planet Hollywood and present their ideas very quickly with some Q&A from our judges, who are going to be Steve Forbes, the billionaire Peter Thiel, John Mackey, the CEO of Whole Foods Markets, and Don Smith, a New York hedge fund manager. This is all going to be judged right there on the spot. We're going to hand the check, $50,000, to the lucky winner.
Wow. That is cool, and it really goes along with the theme of restoring the American dream, because what the American dream is all about entrepreneurialism, about pursuing your happiness, right? Pursuit of happiness. And what better way than that? So
exactly. And it's a for-profit business venture, so we're not doing nonprofits.
Mm-hmm.
So it's exactly what the American dream is all about. So we think this is a great addition to Freedom Fest. So our whole idea is to take Freedom Fest to a whole new level. That's why we're having the Paul Krugman, Steve Moore debate. Krugman has never been willing to debate anyone in any kind of formal way. And after 10 years of knowing Paul Krugman and asking him, he finally agreed to do it. And he thinks Steve Moore is a good choice. He said no to a bunch of our Austrian friends that like Peter Schiff and people like that. I mean, Peter Schiff is dying to debate Paul Krugman. And Krugman has simply refused to debate a lot of these people, but he considers Steve Moore. Now, I will tell you that Paul Krugman once told me when I was in London, this is kind of an inside story for your people. So I was with Paul Krugman in London when he was out there promoting his book, End the Depression Now. And I said, so is there anyone that you could lose to in a debate? And he looked at me like, are you kidding? Nobody can beat me in a debate. And I said, well, what about Milton Friedman? Unfortunately, he's passed away, but couldn't he beat you? And he kind of nodded his head like he said, yeah, I suppose if Milton Friedman were alive, I might lose to him, but that's it. So the guy is really arrogant. And of course, he's like Daniel in the Lion's Den when it comes to Freedom Fest. But, you know, our people, I think, are respectful and are going to give him his due. But we wanted it in a debate format. And the debate, by the way, will not be your usual debate where one person speaks for 10 minutes and the other one responds for 10 minutes. We're going to go issue by issue, blue state versus red state, progressive versus flat tax, austerity versus stimulus, inequality versus growth, Obamacare versus market healthcare solutions. So when we go through each one of those, we'll be able to hopefully confront both debaters on the issues, on their facts. We may even have a fact checker right there, some kind of independent fact checker who's got the computer out and he's Googling and this and that. And he'll raise his hand saying, well, we've just checked the facts and you're wrong, Steve Moore. You're wrong, Paul Krugman. Who knows?
I'm loving it. I'm really loving it.
I think we're going to have major media coverage. Everybody who's listening should be there because it is going to be a private affair. You're going to be able to see it live in Planet Hollywood. That's where you want to see it, not on some TV coverage or something like that. And every person who's there is going to be able to write down their question. We're going to vet all the questions and put as many questions as we can to these two individuals. And it's an hour and 15 minutes, followed by an autograph session. So it's really going to be fun.
Yeah. You know, Ludwig von Mises, rest his soul, he said that the progressives, or whatever you want to call them, the socialists, never want to debate the issues. And if you look at the current state of America today, I don't remember ever hearing a true debate on free markets. I'm not going to say capitalism because that conjures up all sorts of different images. And what we have in America today is not capitalism, but free markets versus socialism. When was the last time you ever really heard a true debate between the two, Mark? You know,
I think this is going to be a unique experience. Every time I bring it up, people's eyes light up. They can't believe we pulled this off. Steve Moore, he just emailed me and said that every time he's out in the public, people come up to him and say, "Hey, I hear you're finally getting to debate Paul Krugman." So, I mean, it's creating a lot of buzz, and we're getting a lot of people signing up. By the way, I should tell you that we're getting near our limit. We're basically giving the early bird discount of $100 off per person or $200 per couple. First 1,000 people who sign up get that discount, and we're approaching that number. I think we'll probably reach that number on December 31st or near it. So if your people want to sign up, they should go to freedomfest.com if they want to get that early bird discount.
Yeah, and I highly encourage you to go there. It's a unique experience. I think the first time I went there, Mark, was 4 years ago. Uh-huh. And, you know, you go most places in the country, they don't know who Ludwig von Mises is. They don't know who Ayn Rand is. And you go to Freedom Fest and I felt like I came home. It's the only way I can describe it. And it's just an amazing experience for 3 days or 4 days that you're just not going to, there's no place like it. And I just can't urge you enough to go there, because it's really an amazing, amazing thing. And, you know, it just this debate and the Entrepreneur Award, the American Dream Award, you're just not going to experience anything like it. So, Mark, changing up gears here.
Yeah.
You've heard this Jonathan Gruber, all the candid comments that he had to make, because, you know, basically progressives are at their worst when they're telling the truth. They're at their most vulnerable. And then he got before a congressional subcommittee, a House subcommittee yesterday on investigations, I guess it was, Darrell Issa's committee. And all of a sudden it's like, well, you know, words are what I mean them to say, nothing more and nothing less, kind of through the looking glass. And, you know, you just got to shake your head, because here we see Obamacare is a huge failure. What are your thoughts on this guy and what's transpiring with Obamacare?
Yeah, no, I think he sounds like a politician. Somebody's gotten to him. He's been reading the press and saying, oh my gosh, the cat's out of the bag. What can I do to put it back in? And of course you can't. The Wall Street Journal had a great little editorial today chastising him for changing his mind. But this is very typical. I mean, look at George H.W. Bush and his read my lips, no new taxes, and then he reverses himself as soon as he gets into office. This is kind of standard operating procedure where politicians lie. Well, in this case, he's not really a politician, but he's become politicized with his views, and so he's backtracking. There's nothing more to say about it other than look, when you go back to that process when they crammed Obamacare through the Senate, changing the rules and engaging in all kinds of shenanigans, it's not surprising that everything that Gruber said applies. It just makes sense, and nice to see somebody really confirm it. And so I'll stick with his original statement. I think that's a more honest view.
Yeah. And okay. So now we're going to have a Republican Congress. We've got Obamacare.
Huge majorities in the House.
Right. So what are they going to do here? Are they going to get rid of Obamacare or the most obnoxious parts of it? Are they just going to let it slide because, you know, they were sent there to do a job, and are they going to do this job? That's what I want to know.
Well, I asked John Fund this basic question. Are we seeing a repeat of what's happening 2000, mm-hmm. I'm going to go back to 2000, because basically the idea is that Republicans could potentially have all three sectors of the government in control in 2016. They're not going to get anything in this next 2 years. They're already compromising, and they don't want to shut down the government, so they're already going ahead with this huge $1 trillion budget. It includes deficits and all that sort of thing. So these Republican leaders are into compromise so that they will look good for 2016 election, and then they'll be reelected. So I asked what John Fund said was, aren't we, you know, what have the Republicans learned anything, or are they still the stupid party? And in the year 2000, Republicans were in control of everything, and look what we got. Just a disaster. So are we going to face the same thing in 2016? But, you know, he said, I don't know. I mean, it's an open question. I think we've learned our lesson, but maybe we haven't. So who's to say? But I don't think anything's going to happen. It's gridlock in the next 2 years. Everything is going to – there's not going to be a change in tax policy. Now, maybe Obama, who tends to be quite more ideological than Clinton, will do some kind of a deal, but it'd be nice to get a – sharp reduction in the corporate tax rate, which is what has been happening in Canada. But otherwise, you have to look to 2016 to have anything done.
Really? So it's just more of the same, huh?
Yes, but not quite more the same, but less. The Republicans are really good at saying no to really bad legislation. The problem was 2009, 2010 is when the Democrats had all three areas of government in control. And what did we get? Yeah. We got Obamacare and we got Dodd-Frank, the two worst pieces of legislation in the last 12 years. And who do we to blame? George Bush and Karl Rove, because they're the ones who drove the Republican Party into the ground during this time period with these wars and with unfunded liabilities and with huge deficits during a peacetime, full employment environment. I mean, it was just tragic what had happened under George W. Bush. And he's the one responsible, has to take personal responsibility for Dodd-Frank and Obamacare passing through. This is legislation that was indirectly caused by Bush's blunders and Karl Rove being the architect of these blunders.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more. And to me, the analog to that is what George Pataki did to the Republican Party in New York State. It's exactly the same thing. The go along, get along, the basically pretty much just caving in on values, having nothing to believe in except holding power, because holding power in and of itself isn't enough. I mean, just to say that we hold power and those guys are going to do even worse than what we're doing isn't enough to keep you in power. You got to have some kind of vision for the country and some kind of positive vision and some kind of vision attached to limited government and a vision based on the founders, right?
Yeah, I do think it has to be ideologically driven, just as we had Obama is in that category, ideologically driven, and he got through some legislation that he thought for him was good for the country. But we need another Reagan type that, even though he compromised way too much, I think, overall, he still had a certain vision of limited government that he wouldn't cross over. And he turned it into a positive message of what we call Reaganomics. And we do need that again. I don't think Romney had a ideological bone in his body, unfortunately. So hopefully if Rand Paul gets in, who is my favorite candidate, again, he's going to be a compromiser and that sort of thing. But he has certain ideological foundations that I think will serve him well if he became president. He sees himself as another Obama in the sense that here's the first libertarian candidate who could really win. And of course, he, as you know, I don't know if you know this or not, but the tallest candidate almost always wins.
Right,
if
that's
you ever
correct.
Looked at this
yeah.
history.
Absolutely.
So the only way that Rand Paul can win is if Hillary Clinton is his opponent.
So I got to be rooting for Hillary? Is that what you're telling me?
I think he's 5'8" or 5'9" at the most.
Yeah. All right. So I either have to root for Hillary to be the candidate of the Democrats, or is that what you're telling me?
That's what I'm saying. You got it. You heard it here first.
I don't know.
By the way, Rand Paul has spoken every year at Freedom Fest, except last year when his handlers took over and became, I don't know what's happening there, but his handlers have definitely taken over his scheduling and stuff. And I don't know if he'll be showing up at Freedom Fest or not, but everybody else is.
Yeah,
in fact, we just got Steve Wynn, confirmed Steve Wynn, who's really the person of all people. He's been very critical, by the way, of Obama.
Yeah.
And he's responsible for the new Las Vegas, the five-star restaurants, the shopping, the new architecture, the the high class entertainment that has come in, to move away from the old Las Vegas kind of just a third rate place where you can gamble and sex shows and all that sort of thing. He really has made a huge difference in that town.
Oh yeah. I mean, yeah, you just, the new Las Vegas, well, him and Michael Milken, kind of the two together, started it off. And yeah, fascinating individual, Steve Wynn. And, you know, when you listen to his critiques of the Obama administration, you know, he doesn't hold anything back.
No, he really doesn't. It's surprising.
Nothing back. And, you know, you wonder, like, why there aren't more people like him speaking out. But, you know, if you look back on the Austrian writings, you understand that businessmen will always basically sell out to further their business interests, right?
Well, that's true. And I think you see a lot of that in Ayn Rand. There are very few principled business people. There are a few who are heroes in Atlas Shrugged and in her other writings, The Fountainhead and so forth. Mises said something interesting one time. He had actually a rather low opinion of business people. Did you know that? Have you ever read his writings about business people, how he says they don't have any particular ideology, they're not intellectually driven, they're just there to do a deal. That's it. So
that's it. Very.
And of course, I told John Mackey that, and he was quite taken aback. He said, "Well, there are a few of us who are ideological and intellectual and do have some interest beyond just making a deal." So
very few.
And those are the kind of people, business people, we want to welcome to Freedom Fest for sure.
Yep. Very few, but there are a few. And, you know, you look at the GEs of the world, and they're fully dependent and reliant upon the largesse of government, and they couldn't survive without it, right?
Well, I think that, I don't know, GE could, I think, survive without the government. I mean, you know, they make some pretty good products and stuff, but most of them are in bed with government, that's for sure.
Yeah, well, maybe they'd survive, but not as profitably. And, you know, the whole fascist state that's in place, you know, it profits from, at, you know, carrying out the government's, you know,
I will. Think someone does need to develop a theory of cronyism, if you will, because you're never going to get away with it. You're never going to escape it, because money begets power. There's no question about it. When you have a lot of money, you throw your weight around, you have influence, you start getting involved with government people automatically. But if we can develop some kind of rules, you know, this is public choice economics, James Buchanan and so forth. If we can develop some rules to minimize the cronyism, that's really where we want to head. Because I don't think you're going to eliminate it. It's just Adam Smith always talked about this. You're never going to eliminate the passions, the frauds, the deceptions of business. But if you can minimize it, if you can just suppress it, that's the best you can do. And that's what his system of natural liberty was all about: competition, system of justice, and maximum economic freedom is your best model that you can do to just kind of cool the passions a little bit, rather than just allowing them to explode.
Yeah, well, limited government is the best solution, but we're a long ways from that. Anyway, Mark, just tell us how we sign up for that discount on Freedom Fest.
Yeah, it's $395, $595, so you get $100. That's $100 off the $495 regular price. And if they go to freedomfest.com, and by the way, we have a new 800 number as well. If people want to look at that, it's 1-855-850-FREE, FREE, or 3733. And that's our new 800 number, toll free, or they just go to freedomfest.com and get all the details.
Excellent. And find the link, as always, in the show notes to this interview on financialsurvivalnetwork.com. Make sure you sign up for our free newsletter. Mark, I will see you at Freedom Fest.
All right, Kerry, take care.
FSN Radio. It's all about what's next.
Every week, the show is growing. Would you like to be a part of it? Then go to clubfsn.com and help support us with $1, $2, $5, or $10 a month and get a host of premium content with newsletters dropped into your mailbox, free books, private audio clips, webinars, and much more. Then join clubfsn.com. If you want to get ahead of the trend and ensure your family's financial security before it's too late, go to clubfsn.com and sign up.
FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get three free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.